Okay, good morning to all of you. Still only 24 students have joined. We will not wait. Let's start. Whether the slide is visible, let me hear please respond.
Yes, sir.
So, let's start, sir. Last class we have discussed some particular types of testing techniques for weather systems, such as content testing and some other kinds of testing we have seen. So three testing techniques we have seen yesterday. So let's see about the remaining testing techniques today. Start with navigation testing. So you hope that you clearly understand the meaning of navigation, because you are all competent students. Let's see why navigation testing is required in case of a best application. Navigation testing is performed on various possible paths in the web-based applications in order to ensure that the functioning or the functioning of the in order to ensure that there is correct functioning of the sequence of navigation. So when you are making any number of navigations, you are making the order is proper. They are performed in the correct sequence, in the correct order. In order to ensure that, you have to perform navigation testing. So navigation testing performed on various possible paths in web applications in order to ensure the proper functioning of the correct sequence of navigations. So how you will design then the test cases for performing navigation testing? First, design the test cases in such a way that the following navigations are correctly executed. So design the test cases in such a manner that the following types of navigations are correctly executed. For example, internal links and external links. If there is any internal link or external link you have given in your web page, that must properly work. It should not fail. Suppose in NIT Raukla we have given a link to UGC. That is an external link. So while you are testing this, so when you are going to NIT Raukla website and you are moving into from that the UGC website, it should properly connect, it should properly execute, it should not fail. Must test that thing. Similarly, redirected links. Whenever you are using any redirected link in your page, so these redirected links should be with proper messages displayed to the user. It should give sufficient messages to the user so that the user can know why this redirected link is used. So proper messages should be displayed. Similarly, for another reason also, you should design the test cases such as navigation for searching inside the web application. So inside your particular web application, you want to search something. The proper methodology should be there. You might have seen in every software on the top right hand corner, there must be a search button, search field. So there should be proper navigation for searching inside the current web application. So you have to design the test cases in such a way that the following navigations they are correctly executed. The errors must be checked for the following. So when you are testing when you are performing navigation testing, you must check for the errors. Let's see what kind of errors you must check. The errors must be checked for the following points, like if there is any broken link or the link you are giving, whether this is properly working or it is broken. So if broken, then appropriate error message should be displayed. The broken link, the link should not be broken due to any reason. Whatever reason may be, if any link you have given, it should not broken, it should not say that, sorry, it is not, the web page is not available or something. It should not be broken. For that you must test. Well, the proper redirected link should proper messages displayed. Whenever any redirected link you are giving, so proper messages should appear, and you should ensure that no error is occurring while moving to the redirected links. Ensuring whether all possible navigation paths are active and relevant or not. So how many navigation paths may be there when you are starting from the current web page, you are gradually going inside or some other links. So we have to ensure that whether all the possible navigation paths they are active or not, or some of the navigation paths for the temporal they are inactive or something, and whether they are relevant or not. So accordingly, if they are irrelevant, some message actually should be displayed. So you have to ensure that thing, the errors must be checked for this thing. Then the navigations for the backward and forward buttons, if they are and they are proper working. Whenever you see any website, there is it. Actually, you can see three buttons are there important. One is backward and this forward and the refresh. So whenever you are making the navigations for the backward and the forward buttons, you must see that they are properly working or not. But in some cases, you see backward button, they are not given. You see, go to banking application. You just press backward, it will not work. So due to some security reasons, in many cases, the backward and forward buttons, they have inactivated. So if it is activated, they should work properly. That you must test, they should not fail, okay? Next testing, we'll see configuration and the compatibility testing. So you know that the normally the web-based applications are diverse in nature. Yesterday I was saying one of the challenges for testing web-based applications, that is diversity. So diversity in configuration for the web-based applications makes the testing process of these systems very much difficult. Due to this diversity nature, the testing process becomes much more difficult. So now let's see how it is diverse. There may be various types. So why you will say that these web-based applications are diverse in nature? The diversity in configuration for web applications occurs. Why? There may be various types of browsers supporting different operating systems. You can see that there is Google Chrome, Mozilla Firefox, and this Internet Explorer, etc. And they may support the different operating system. Somebody something is supporting all the operating systems. Something is supporting, or some browser is supporting only Windows. Some browser is supporting only Unix, like that. So that's one of the reason for diversity. There are different browsers supporting different operating systems. Also, there are variations in the different servers. There are variations in different networks, etc. So there may be these various kinds of types, so this may lead to diversity in the configuration of the web applications. And since they are diverse in nature, so testing these web applications becomes very much difficult. Therefore, configuration testing becomes very much important, so that there is compatibility between various available resources and application software. There should not be any incompatible. So there is since they are diverse in nature, so that's why you must perform configuration testing. The configuration testing becomes much more important, so that what will ensure that? So that you can ensure that there is compatibility between these various available resources and the application software. The tester must consider these configurations and the compatibility issues. Okay? The tester, he must consider all these available configurations and the compatibility issues, so that they can design the test cases incorporating all the configurations. While they will design the test cases, they should ensure that they are considering what possible configurations. Some important points while you are performing configuration testing are as follows. Number one, there are a number of different browsers and browser options, I have already told you. A number of browser options are there. The web application you have to design, or in such a way, the web application you have to design is that they should be compatible for majority of the browsers. They may not be compatible for all the browsers, but majority of the browsers they should support. The web application has to be designed in such a way that they have to be compatible for majority of the browsers. So in some cases, you see this, when you are developing the web pages, graphics plays an important role. So the graphics and the other objects, on the website have to be tested in multiple browsers, because I was saying the examples last class. When you are using a different browser, the graphics is coming differently, the visibility is becoming something different. So in some cases, they will not be at all visible. I was saying the example while taking the printout of the attendance sheet in one. Firefox, the lines are not coming, separated lines, but while taking in the Google Chrome, then they are coming. So that means we must test the graphics and the other objects on the website, and we should ensure that the quality is better, the quality is good in almost all of the browsers. So the graphics and other objects on the website, they have to be tested on multiple browsers. If more than one browser will be supported, then the graphics have to be visually checked for differences in physical appearance. So if your web page is supported by Google Chrome or Mozilla Firefox, etc., if more than one browser will be supported by your application, your web application, then you have to ensure that the graphics that is showing, the graphics have to be visually checked for the differences in the physical appearance, whether the graphics that is displayed by the different browsers, they are same or they are much different, or the quality deteriorates into large extent, so that have to be properly checked. Some of the things to check when your web application is supported by multiple browsers are as follows. You have to see that centering of the objects, whatever objects are there, they are properly centered. It's in one of our rights, it is in for one browser, it is coming at the left, in another case it is centered, in another case right, that will not look nice. So you have to see that if your software, your application, your web application is supported by multiple browsers, the objects are placed in the central position properly. Okay, you have to ensure that the objects are placed in the central position properly. Similarly, the table layouts are proper, the colors are proper, they are visible, they are not faded. Monitor resolution is proper. The forms are looking nicely, they are looking appropriately. The forms are properly visible. The buttons are properly appearing. Okay, all those things you must have to test while you are considering that, or while you are observing that your best application, it has to be supported by multiple browsers. Then you have to check all those points, okay? The code that executes from the browser also has to be tested. So whatever code you have written, the code that executes from the browser, that also has to be tested. You know that normally while you are using web-based applications, you are using HTML. You know that there are also different versions of HTML. They are similar in some ways. So all those versions, they are similar in some ways, but they have different tags which may produce different features. So since they are having different tags in the HTML, those who have known HTML, you have known there are different tags. So since they have different tags, they may produce different features. So we must have to test. When we are using different versions of HTML, we must test that the different versions of HTML are producing similar results, and the results, they are not deteriorating. Some of the other codes besides HTML, if you are using, they have to be tested. So some of the other codes besides HTML to be tested are maybe Java, JavaScript, ActiveX, VBScript, CGI Bin scripts, database assets. So these things also must be tested properly while you are testing your best applications. So the CGI Bin scripts, they have to be checked for the end-to-end operations, and they are most essential for e-commerce sites. So one of the particular code I have written is CGI Bin scripts. So normally they are useful for developing e-commerce sites or e-commerce applications. These CGI Bin scripts, they have to be checked very thoroughly for end-to-end operations, which are most essential for e-commerce sites. So the same also goes for the database assets. The same thing is also is true for database assets. That means whenever you are using database assets in web-based applications, they have to be checked thoroughly for the different operations. Okay. All the new technologies which are used in the web development, like the graphics technology or the graphics design, interface calls, like different APIs, they may not be available in all the operating systems. Please remember, different operating systems, they support different features. So all the recent technologies, all the new technologies which are used in the web development, such as the graphic designs, interface calls, like the different APIs, etc., they may not be available, they may not be present in all the operating systems. So we have to test your web applications on different operating systems. So whenever you are developing any web application, you have to test your web application on different operating systems. So the operating says that the web application that you will test on different operating systems are as follows. So you have to test your web applications in Windows operating systems, Linux operating system, Mac operating system, Linux operating system, Solaris with different operating system flavors, etc. So you have to, not only you say that my web application is perfectly working on Windows, I will not test for Unix. No, because there are several other users, they are using Unix or Mac or Linux. So besides testing your web application in Windows, you have to test your web application on different operating systems. You have to test your web application in Unix, Mac, like Linux, etc. Then you will go for another important technique, that is security testing, very, very important. The most important technique that you must perform for web-based applications. You know that the most challenging issue for your web-based applications is to protect the web applications from different hackers, crackers, spoofers, virus launchers, etc. Isn't it? Once you have developed a website, you must ensure that your website is protected from the different hackers, crackers, spoofers, virus launchers, etc. See, we are having an MTech program in information security. So the MTech students, once they told that, sir, what is our gateway system for the payment, we can easily hack it. They have written some code to hack it. We have immediately informed to the our registrar director, see, you do take the necessary action. If our students are able to hack it outside, easily they will hack it. So we must develop certain techniques so that we must ensure that our website is protected from the different hackers, crackers, spoofers, virus launchers, etc. Otherwise, anybody else can steal the data from your website. Anybody can misuse your website. So the most challenging issue is to protect the web applications from the hackers, crackers, spoofers, virus launchers, etc. Through security testing, we should try to ensure proper confidentiality of the website, integrity of the website, proper availability of the website, non-repudiation, etc. The web application must be able to nullify the external attack. So whenever any external attacker tries to attack your system, the web application should be developed in such a way that it must be able to nullify the attacks made by the external external user. Okay. Now let's see how to make the test plan for the security testing. So the security test plan, let's see. The security testing is carried out for what? Mainly two purposes. Security testing is carried out for ensuring security of the infrastructure hosting the web application and to handle the vulnerabilities of the web application. Okay. So security testing in web-based applications is carried out for two important reasons. To ensure that security of the infrastructure infrastructure hosting the web application and to handle the vulnerabilities of the web application. You can use firewalls and port scans, isn't it? So firewall and port scans can be the solutions for security infrastructure that you can use also. That's why every organization, those who are using web-based applications, websites, they have their own firewall. In our institute also, we are having our firewall. For handling vulnerabilities, user authentication, restricted and encrypted user cookies, data communication must be planned. Okay, so whenever you are trying to handle the vulnerabilities, so you should plan for the proper user authentication, restricted and encrypted use of the cookies. Data communication, they must be planned properly. The user should not be able to browse with your directories in the server. So you should not allow the users to browse through the different directories in the server. These are some of the measures that you can take for handling vulnerability. Now let's see some of the initiatives that you should see. That you should ensure for security testing. You have to check the interfaces of the components, isn't it? Because your website consists of many components. You have to check the proper interfaces of the components, because most of the security bugs, they lie on the interfaces only. The majority of the security bugs, they lie on the interfaces of the components. So you have to check properly the interfaces of the components. You have to prioritize the interfaces according to the level of vulnerability. Which interfaces is highly vulnerable to threats? You have to give priority number one. You have to give more priority to that. Then the next one, So you have to prioritize the interfaces according to the level of vulnerability. Suppose you are having, let's take this NIT Roorkee system, your student registration. So let's take two interfaces. One interface with the student database, two interface with the payment gateway. So which will be given more priority? Of course, interfacing with the payment gateway should be given more priority because there is a heavily chance that it may be missing. So prioritize interfaces according to their level of vulnerability. High priority interfaces are tested thoroughly by injecting mutated data. So which are high priority interfaces, such as the payment gateway, etc. High priority interfaces, they are tested very much thoroughly by injecting the mutated data to be processed by that interface in order to check the security. So you have to test the high priority interfaces very much thoroughly by injecting the mutated data. While performing security checking, do not modify the following things. Okay, while you are performing conducting security testing, the following items should not be modified. What are they? The configuration of the system or the server. So when you are performing security testing, don't modify the configuration of the system or the server. Similarly, if any services are currently running on the server, you should not modify them during performing the security testing because the whole application will be affected. Similarly, if there is some existing user or some customer data hosted by the application and you are performing security testing, don't modify anything else. Don't change to the existing user data or customer data hosted by the application. So whenever you are performing security testing, these following items should not be modified or changed. Let's see some of the possible various threat types and their corresponding test cases. So these are the possible threats which may happen to your software, to your web-based application. And let's see how you will handle them. For test cases, you should design corresponding to these threat types. First threat type, unauthorized users or fake identity or password cracking. Very common thing, only I am putting in a formal manner. You know all those things. That's the one of the most important threat, that there can be some unauthorized users or there is some user is entering with fake identity or somebody is trying to crack the password. So this is one of the various threat type. So for this, what you should do? You should check for the confidentiality of the content of the data. So for handling this threat, that is unauthorized users or fake identity or password cracking, you have to check for the confidentiality of the content of data. Next threat is buffer overflows. So just please, 1 second, please. Sorry for the interruption. So next threat is buffer overflows. Buffer overflows means due to this, malicious code can be executed, isn't it? So due to buffer overflows, malicious code can be executed, which is harmful for your system. So what you have to do? You have to check the buffer overflow module. So whatever may be this module, so there may be a module for overflow module. You have to check the buffer overflow module and the different ways of submitting a range of links to the application. What are the possible different ways of submitting a range of links to the application that has to be properly handled? So check the buffer overflow module and the different ways of submitting a range of links to the application. Next possible threat is URL manipulation. So let's see how the attackers, they can manipulate the URL. You know, the web applications, they use a method called as HTTP GET method. Normally, the web applications, they use a method called as HTTP GET. Why? This method is used to pass information between the client and the server. Now what happens? The information, how it is passed? The information is passed through some parameters in the query string. Now let's see what the attacker can do. An attacker may change some information in the query string. So an external attacker, what he may do, he can change some information or a portion of the information, some part of the information in the query string, which is passed from the GET request, so that he may get some information or corrupt the data. In this way, the attacker, he can change some information of the query string, which is passed from the GET request, so that what he can do, he can get some information or he can corrupt the data. An attacker may change some information in the query string passed from the GET request, so that he may either get some information from that query string or he may corrupt the data. So when somebody attempts to modify the data, some external attacker, he is attempting to modify the data, it is known as the fiddling of data. Okay, so if an attacker is trying to modify the data or information or corrupt it, it is known as fiddling of data. So what we have to do, how to handle this thing, how to test this thing? So you have to prevent fiddling in the HTTP GET query string for the change or corruption of the data. So somehow we have to prevent this fiddling in this HTTP GET query string for this change or corruption of the data, so that what will happen, any attacker, he cannot access this data, he cannot change the data, he cannot corrupt the data. You have to design test cases to check that an user is trying to modify the private information. So you consider as an external user, attacker, and try to enter into the system, try to modify the private information. See, if you are able to do that, means some problem is there. So you have to make it robust in such a way that any user who don't have access to that, he cannot enter into that system and he cannot modify the private information. So we have to design the test cases to check that an user, if he is trying to modify the private information, he is not able, he cannot modify the private information. Okay, this is about how you can prevent the URL manipulation. Next is the SQL injection. SQL injection, you have already known, only I will put in a formal way. So several times the hackers put some SQL statements through the web interface or the inputs to get the vital information they will try. And how to handle it? We have to design the test cases in such a way that the special characters from the user inputs should be handled or escaped properly. We have to design the test case in such a way that the different special characters from the user inputs, they should be either handled properly or they should be completely escaped properly, so that any outsider cannot put some SQL statements to get the or to steal the vital information. Next attack is DOS, very much important. It's known as denial of service. In short, we call that DOS attack. Those who have studied a paper, I think right now is offered on intrusion detection system. I think Sujata madam is taking the intrusion detection system. There you might have heard these terms, different types of attacks, how to handle. So one such attack is DOS attack or denial of service attack. So what do you mean by DOS? So DOS means when a service does not respond, it is known as denial of service. So you have requested for a service and the service, it does not respond. So when a service does not respond, it is known as denial of service. So this is an important attack that we must handle it. There are several ways that can make an application fail. Okay. So why is a service is not responding? Maybe there is some failure. So what could be the reasons for the failure? What are the ways that what system can make an application fail? So there are several ways that can make an application fail. Maybe number one, due to heavy load, the load is very heavy. Due to heavy load, the application may fail. Similarly, due to distorted data that may crash an application, then also the system will fail. And another reason could be overloading of the memory. Due to overloading of the memory, the application may fail, etc. These are few reasons I have given here. Other reasons you know, there are several other reasons for which the application may fail. So, and if the application is failing, the service does not respond. So if the service does not respond, we say that this is a denial of service. Then how to test it? The tester should design the test cases considering all the above factors. So we have to test whether the load is proper or it is heavy. whether there is any presence of any distorted data which may crash the application, so we have to ensure that, and we have to take preventive measures out that will not be distorted. Similarly, whether there is overloading of memory, if that, how to handle this, we have to ensure that. So we have to design test cases in such a way that these above factors, they can be properly tested. So this is something of about DoS. Another extension of DoS is known as DDoS. Those who have known that intrusion detection system might have heard DDoS, DDoS stands for distributed, distributed denial of service. Okay. So those things, please have a look into this, what any books or these internet applications. So you can see these are very important attacks. Other important attacks, those who have studied again that intrusion detection system like U2R, user to root, probes. Okay, these are different other attacks. These are different other threats. So I do not have sufficient time to discuss all those things. So you can see any intrusion detection book or any web materials for the different types of attacks and their solutions. So next important threat you will see is XSS. It stands for cross-site scripting. So before going to how to handle cross-site scripting, let's see what do you mean by cross-site scripting. When a user inserts any HTML or client-side script, okay, whenever any user inserts the HTML or client-side script in the user interface of a web application, and this insertion is visible to the outside users, then it is called as cross-site scripting. I'm repeating again. This may come in the examination. What do you mean by cross-site scripting? So when any user, he inserts the HTML or the client-side script here in the user interface of a web application, and this insertion, it is visible to the outside users, it is visible to the attackers, it is called as cross-site scripting. So what is the problem if cross-site scripting there, how it is dangerous? Using this cross-site scripting, the attackers, they can use scripts like JavaScript, etc. to steal user cookies and information stored in the cookie. So by using this cross-site scripting, the attackers, they can use some scripts like JavaScript, etc. to steal the user cookies and the information stored in the cookie. So you must have to prevent this. To avoid this, the tester should check the web application for XSS. You have to develop some test cases to check, to test the web application for the presence of XSS. Okay. Then we'll quickly look at the performance testing. Performance testing we have already discussed while discussing the system testing. So different performance testings we have seen there, such as loads testing, stress testing, volume testing, compatibility testing, etc. So here let's see how this performance testing can be applied to the web applications. Performance testing, it helps the developers to identify the different bottlenecks in the web applications, and they can be rectified. The bottlenecks could be the code itself, the database, the network, the peripheral devices that you are using. They could be the possible bottlenecks. So so this performance testing, it helps the developers to detect the bottlenecks present in the web application, and they can be rectified. Let's see performance parameters. So different performance testing techniques are there. Now let's see how the efficiency of the performance testing can be measured. The efficiency of the performance testing can be measured through some parameters. They are called as performance parameters. So some of the parameters here you will see, you must have already known, these are very easy definitions. Like one parameter is called as resource utilization. How do you define resource utilization? So resource utilization is defined as the percentage of time a resource is busy. Okay. So resource utilization means the percentage of the time that a resource is busy. The resource could be a CPU, could be a memory, could be IO device, could be a peripheral device, could be a network, etc. So in that way, you can measure the resource utilization. Another performance parameter is throughput. Very common definition we have seen earlier. So throughput means what? The number of event responses that have been completed over a given interval of time. So during a given period of time, what is the number of event responses that have been completed? That's known as throughput. response time, the time which is elapsed between a request and its reply or response. So when you have sent a request message and you have got its response, the time that is elapsed in between this request and reply is called a response time. So response time means the time which is elapsed between the request and its reply or response. Another performance parameter is round trip time. Round trip time means it is defined as follows. How long does the entire user requested transaction take, including the connection and processing time? So when you are passing some message, it will take some time for setting the connection. It will take time some processing time. So if you take combine the connection time and the processing time, then you can get the round trip time. So round trip time, it can be defined as follows. How long does the entire user requested transaction take, including connection and processing time? So next parameter is scalability, very common term. Scalability means what? The ability of an application to handle additional workload. So how far it is, scalable? How far you can extend the ability of the application to handle additional workload without adversely affecting performance? You can stretch it without what affecting the performance. So currently you are what at a point you are handling 15 students. So whether it can be extended to 20, 25 like that. So in that you can say the application is scalable, but the performance is not degraded. So the ability of an application to handle additional workload without adversely affecting performance by adding resources such as processor, memory, and storage capacity, right? So scalability means the ability of a web application to handle the additional workload without adversely affecting the performance, maybe by adding different resources such as processor, memory, and storage capacity. So next performance parameter is database load. Database load is defined as number of times the database is accessed by the web application over a given interval of time. So over a given period of time, how many times the database is accessed by the web application, that's called as database load. So these are some of the performance parameters which you can use to measure the efficiency of the web application or the efficiency of the testing technique for the performance testing technique of the web applications. So let's quickly see some of the important types of performance testing for the web applications. So one is load testing, another is stress testing. Already these testing techniques we have discussed while discussing the system testing for this procedural programs, almost similar. I will just quickly revise it. So first let's see the load testing. So here this testing is performed to check that whether the system can sustain at times of peak load. So when the load is peak, the highest amount of load, then also the system can work perfectly without any deterioration. So load testing, this testing is performed to check that whether the system can sustain at times of peak load. The website should handle many simultaneous user requests, large input data from users, simultaneous connections to database, heavy load on specific pages, etc. I am giving a small example. See, when you will come to the campus, you see every year, every semester, there is a pre-registration and registration. So when there is a pre-registration, okay, you are doing from your home, but when you did the registration, the faculty advisor has to register one by one. So all the people will come to the faculty advisor's room, stay in a queue, and then he calls one by one. See, on the same day, only one day is given for the registration. And in our institute, more than 5,000 students are there. So suddenly what happens, the website, it gets actually choked. It will not respond. Why? Because these office automation people, they have not properly tested this, performed this load testing. Since at a time, 5,000 persons are clicking to that registration page and the faculty advisors are approving that one, it gets struck. It gets struck, does not work, does not respond. So this is the thing that, okay, when you are doing with the fine, only few students, immediately within 1 second it clicks. But in the first day, when you will come, you will see it takes several times. So we say that to the students, okay, please in the come in the afternoon or please come in the evening or the night, we will try. So similarly in the railway, you can see during this peak time or the tatkal time, may not respond. Bank, you go several times, you will say that net is not working, this what server is not working. You will be there in the queue, but server is not working, they will say. So the site should handle many simultaneous user requests, large input data from users, simultaneous connections to database, because at a time, see, 100 users, thousands users are what connecting to your database, maybe to the railway database or some other database, bank database. Heavy load on specific pages. In our case, only in IT Raghula, the registration page only. So heavy load on the specific pages, etc. So the site, your website should handle these cases. When you test the system with these type of loads, we call, or this testing is called as load testing. The load testing focuses on what? The load testing focuses on determining or validating the performance characteristics of the system, okay? So load testing focuses on determining or validating the performance characteristics of the system when subjected to the workloads, okay? So when subjected to heavy workloads, this load testing focuses on determining or validating the performance characteristics of the web application or of the system. And the load volumes expected during production operations. So what volumes or what load we are expecting during production, you give deliberately the maximum load. So load testing, it focuses on determining and validating the performance characteristics of the system. When they are subjected to workloads and load volumes expected during production operations. The load testing, it refers to how much maximum load can be put on the web application. Very simple, very often is asked in examination, what do you mean by load testing? Explain with an example. So load testing refers to how much maximum load, okay? How much maximum load can be put on your particular website. It refers to how much maximum load can be put on the web application. And it will still serve flawlessly. It will work. It will not deteriorate. Even if you have given the maximum load, it is not failing. It is not deteriorating. It will still serve flawlessly. For example, 10 concurrent users. So you have designed the system maybe for 8 users, but you are giving 10 concurrent users. Still, it is working without any fail, without any degradation. So this is known as load testing. What are the different types of load testing? We'll see some particular types of load testing. First one is capacity testing. So this type of load testing, it determines the maximum load that the web service can handle before failing. So before fails, what is the maximum load it can tolerate? Say you have designed for 8 users, concurrent users, but another 2 due to say heavy counter loss, another 2 have opened, 10 it is working, but when it is going to 11, it is failing. So that means capacity training, it says that you can say that even if it designed for 8, it can work up to 10 users, 10 concurrent users, after 10 it will fail. So capacity testing determines the maximum load the web service can handle before failing. It reveals the web service's ultimate limit, isn't it? What is the final limit? What is the ultimate limit? It reveals that. For example, maximum it can go to 10. So it is its ultimate limit. So maximum 10 users can work concurrently, simultaneously at a given point of time. Next, another type of load testing is scalability testing. So this testing determines how effectively the web service will expand to accommodate an increasing load. So in order to accommodate an increasing load, how effectively the web service can expand. So that's called scalability testing. You just go on adding, say, 8 users, then and one more, and then what another user like that. So you just extend your system. You scale the system. It determines how effectively the web application it will expand to accommodate an increasing load. So these are some of the important types of load testing. So I have told there are two types of load performance testing we will discuss. One is load testing, next is stress testing. Let's quickly look at this stress testing. What do you mean by stress? Stress means, or stress refers to stretching the system beyond its specification limits. What is the limit you have specified? Beyond that, you stretch it. As we are saying, Its limit was to handle 10 concurrent users. You deliberately stretch it by giving 11 concurrent users, 12 concurrent users, etc. So stress refers to stretching the system beyond its specification limits. Web stress testing is performed for what? What is the reason why you should perform web stress testing? Web stress testing is performed to break the site. Deliberately, you will want to break the system. Stress testing already we have discussed earlier. Similar thing I am just repeating, maybe for only extending to web-based applications. Web stress testing is performed to break the site. How? By giving stress. What is stress? I have already told you. Stress means stretching the system beyond its specification limit. So web stress testing means, why it is performed? Web stress testing is performed to deliberately break the website. How? By giving stress and to know how the system reacts to the stress and how the system recovers from the crashes. So you will deliberately stress the system, then see how the system is reacting to the stress. When you are stretching the system, how the system is reacting, and then how the system recovers from the crash. So if during this stretching process, suppose the system crashes, then how the system can recover the crash. That is also one of the objective of performing web stress testing. So stress testing also focuses on determining or validating the performance characteristics of the system when they are subjected to conditions beyond those expected during production operation. So during production operation, something is expected, that's fine. But beyond this expectation, beyond this expected what are conditions, when you are putting your system beyond some of the expected conditions, what will happen to the production operation? How the system will behave? How to determine how to validate that the performance at that time? This is one of the objective, or this is one of the focus of stress testing. So I'm repeating again. It means the stress testing, it focuses on determining or validating the performance characteristic of the system when it is subjected to the conditions which are beyond those expected during production operation. So how to perform this stress testing? So the stress testing tests the performance of the system under stressful conditions. So deliberately we are stretching the system, delivering, we are applying stress. So the stress testing, it tests the performance of the system under stressful conditions. The examples of stressful conditions would be memory overflow, disk space is insufficient, there's a failure in the server, etc. So these are some of the examples of stressful conditions. So stress testing, it tests the performance of the system under stressful conditions such as memory overflow, insufficient disk space, server failure, etc. Okay, this is something about stress testing. So we have seen two important types of performance testing, that is load testing and stress testing. So these tests are designed. So now let's see how to design the test cases for stress testing. These tests are designed to determine under what conditions an application will fail and how gracefully it may recover from failure. So we have to design the test cases in such a way that for stress testing, we should design the test cases in such a way that it should determine under what conditions a web application will fail, and if it has failed, how gracefully it may recover from failure. How it can recover from failure, how gracefully it may recover from failure without completely stopping the system, without completely making failed the system. Some here I have given, what do you mean by graceful failure? I have given some examples of graceful failure. The system saves, one example is the system saves the state at the time of failure and does not crash suddenly. When a failure has occurred, it immediately saves that one and it does not crash suddenly. That's why you know those who have studied the distributed systems, you might have known checkpoints, checkpoint and recovery. That means periodically, say after 1 minute or so, the system automatically saves this state. And when any failure occurs, only it will lose the data from the last saved state. All other previous information is stored. So it will not crash the system suddenly. This is one graceful failure. So, and that's why the example you can see MS Word you have to take in. Nowadays the MS Word versions, it auto, you need not have to save every time. It automatically saves periodically. So whenever the system will fail or there is a sudden power shutdown, so you need not have to retype again. It will, up to the last point when the power has failed, it will be saved up to that. You have to only type those few things might be left, otherwise majority of the contents will be there. Another example of graceful failure is on restarting it, the system recovers from the last good state. So suppose there is a crash, a failure or a power shutdown. So when you will restart the system, it will recover from where? From the last good state, because it has already periodically saved the state of the system. So when you will restart the system, here the system will recover from the last good state, so that the failure is not sudden. The failure is gracefully. The failure there is a gracefully failure. Okay, there is a graceful failure. The system is recovering. The system is recovering gracefully from failure. Another example, the system shows meaningful error messages to the user. Suppose some wrong thing you have done or some fault is going to occur, so that should be a meaningful error message should be displayed. See, when you are using laptops and you see that you have your battery is going down, you have not recharged it, what is showing? Sorry, only 10% battery charge is there, please connect your battery. So whenever any failure is going to occur, just prior to that, some meaningful error message should be displayed. Okay, so the system should show some meaningful error messages, either just prior to the failure or before the failure or the time of failure to the user. Okay. So these are some of the examples of graceful failure. So the objective is that you should develop the web page in such a way that whenever any failure will occur, the system should not crash immediately. It should try to recover in a graceful manner from the failure. Okay, this is something about stress testing. So in this way, we have seen two performance testing techniques applicable to web-based applications. One is load testing, another is stress testing. Okay. This is something about performance testing of web-based applications. Okay, we have seen two performance testing techniques, that is load testing and stress testing for web-based applications. This is something about the performance testing of web-based applications. So today we have discussed the remaining types of testing techniques for web-based systems. We have first started with navigation testing, then we have seen configuration and compatibility testing, then security testing, and finally we have seen performance testing of web-based applications. Many other details are there in other books or in other several internet resources. Please have a look into them by yourselves. We have taken again this thing from Naresh Chauhan's book from chapter 15. Please have a look into that. Thank you very much. So in this way, we have seen only the basic concepts, the fundamental concepts of web-based testing. If you have any doubt, please ask right now. Either any doubt of the previous classes or any doubt on this class, please ask right now. So I'm not responding any question. Of course, this is a quite easy chapter. You can read what yourself, just theoretical, and you can see other books and other internet sources for the details. So if any doubt, you can ask. Otherwise, we have to stop. Since no doubts are coming, we'll stop now.
Sir, so, no, sir, any plan? Labs for load testing kind of stuff?
Load testing, see, labs, see, either BTEC students are not joining, PhD students are not joining, still my lab class is going on. Last class, we have taken a tool for load testing. Last Tuesday, we have taken a lab class on JMeter. Gemeter is a free tool available for load testing. Last Tuesday, we have conducted, I think, MTech students can say, I think last class the Gemeter has been done. So today again, there is a lab class we will do for security testing. Those who are interested can join 1:15. We'll to use a tool called the Peach. Peach is a tool which is used for security testing of web applications. That will be performed on today. So if anybody else interested can join that.
Join, sir. Yeah.
So today already load testing we have finished last class Gemeter. And today, because about load testing, this is not the first class. We have already discussed while discussing the security what system testing. There I have discussed load testing, stress testing, volume testing, etc. Based on that, Gemeter has been already covered on the last class. So today we will discuss this security testing tool that is Peach in this class. So if MTech students, it is a must. I request the PhD students and BTech students who are free, they can join. They can call and I will tell my what student or I will accept them and will do. Okay. I have added only MTech and PhD students there. If any BTech students will tell, you just send me a message, I will add them. So since there are no more questions, we can stop now. Thank you very much. Tomorrow we'll take the class at 3:30. Is it 3:30 or what? MTech student Siddharth? Or something. I think I have said, sent the timetable. It was 3:30 to 5:30 for tomorrow.
Okay, yes, sir.
Okay, thank you very much.
Hello.
So, Dinesh, sir, can I shut the meeting?